All right, it's time to start. Good morning, everyone. My name is George Nassis from Aspetar. I'm from Aspetar, Qatar, Orthopedic Sports Medicine Hospital. And I'm delighted to introduce the session on achieving top performance in injury prevention in football from science and practice. And I'm also very glad to welcome all of you and also the excellent speakers that are with me, Professor Les Podlock from the United States and Professor Tim Mayer from Germany. Our aim in this session is to discuss the etiology and the risk factors for injury in football and at the end propose some practical steps on how to prevent the injuries in football. Without saying more things, the first talk, as you know, from the program is about the workload performance, workload monitoring, performance enhancements, enhancement in injury risk. And a few things about my background. I'm an exercise physiology working, as I said, in Aspetar. I'm leading the Excellence in Football project, aiming to implement sports science in all youth teams across the state of Qatar. Before I joined Aspetar, I was academic staff at the University of Athens in Greece and the head of performance of Panathinaikos Football Club for a number of years. I'm a member of the editorial board of the Science and Medicine Football Journal and also a senior associate editor for the British Journal of Sports Medicine. So if we go back 2,500 years ago, Hippocrates was the first to set the stage for the assessment of the workload and actually for the perception of physical exertion and effort. In the late 50s, the so-called East Europe scientists and coaches introduced the metric of the pace at a given distance, and they used to do repeated bouts of a certain distance in order to account, quantify the workload. As you know, the RPE, the Rate of Perceived Exertion, was introduced in the 1970, and that was a real revolution at that time. But moving forward, in the 1975, workload, the heart rate-based workload, I think changed the perception and the work of the practitioners, and this was due to the nice work of a Canadian physiologist, Eric Bannister, Professor Eric Bannister. The launch of the wearable heart rate monitors in the early 80s was another revolutionary step in the history of workload monitoring, and actually based on the data from these heart rate monitors, the training impulse was introduced as a metric. Professor Carl Foster in the late 90s proposed the use of the RPE-based training load, which is simply the product of the RPE in the training time, and this metric is widely used nowadays. Going now more specifically into football, this is probably the first time that tried to quantify training load, workload in football. And Professor Jan Ekstrand from Sweden published this study in 1986. And what actually they did, they had semi-professional, I would say amateur players at that time, at the very early age of research in football, and they had plotted the practice, the ratio of practice to game with the injury incidence for these players. And as you can see, this ratio is probably an index of fitness because the higher the practice time, these players did not use to practice a lot. So the higher the practice time, the better the fitness for this player. And I believe this study was the first one to introduce the idea of the role of fitness in injury prevention. And as you know, and as you have seen from some studies here in this conference, Now, aerobic fitness is considered as a key factor affecting the relationship between workload and injuries. And this is a nice summary by Tim Gabbett, which clarifies that a low training load will lead into increased injury risk, which of course will increase into increased risk of subsequent injury, and low training load will also result in poor performance in football players, in team sport players. On the other side, adequate training load will decrease the soft tissue injury risk and will result in good performance, and that's the relationship between workload and injury and performance. You are probably aware about this relationship for the team sport athletes, which is the relationship between training load and the likelihood of injury at different phases, different periods during the season, pre-season, early competition, and late competition. And I would like to draw your attention into some points and possibly initiate discussions about the way that we analyze or interpret the data. For instance, if you look at this value of 4,000 units, you can identify that for the same workload, pre-season and late competition risk is higher compared to the other periods. And if this is the case, this might have implication into the interpretation and analysis of the data that we collect. This is a very nice relationship. This is also a hot topic in the literature, also very attractive to the practitioner. This relationship describes the acute to chronic workload ratio with the likelihood of injury. And you know this green area, which is the area suggested that being associated with lower risk injury compared to the red area, which is considered as the danger zone. But I would like to draw your attention that there are few studies in football. More are published every month, every few months, and the majority, the vast majority of these studies are in youth. So we don't really know what's the relationship in the senior teams. And actually, we don't know how this plan, how this relationship might fit into the training periodization model. And for those that work in the field with the senior and especially with the high-level football teams, they know that some teams follow a different periodization model, like the tactical periodization, which is very popular in some countries, or others are using modified approaches of block periodization. So I'm wondering if this relationship holds true for professional high-level players, but this is still to be answered. Currently, there is a plethora of different approaches that are used to quantify training load. And in this study, we have asked the practitioners and sports scientists in the clubs, in 40 clubs from high-level leagues, to give us their feedback about the methods they use to quantify training load. And if you look at the upper part of this graph, which describes the training load methods for the during the quantification of workload during training, you can use that they use a variety of methods, including also the RPE. And I would like to stay into this RPE story, because this is very popular, is very convenient, very easy to apply, but we should consider if it is accurate and if it is the most appropriate method to quantify the training load. Going back to the initial study from Franco and Perigeri that introduced the RPE in football, I would like to remind you that in this wonderful study, they have did the association between RPE-based training load and heart rate-based training load quantification. And their findings was that this association rates between 0.50 to 0.77. In a study that we did with high-level youth football players, we followed them, we monitored the RPE in every training session for the whole year, and then we plotted the weekly training load after a match that we lost, after a draw, and after a win. And as you can see from this data, the RPE was lower after winning a match compared with the other two conditions, which remind us, actually, that RPE is a multifactorial and actually is the perception, the personal perception of physical exertion, and it is the outcome of a complex interaction of biological, physiological, psychological, and other factors. So this should be taken into account, I believe, when we attempt to interpret the data from the RPE-based training load. But then the next question is, do the highly trained football players become fatigued? And this is also a nice question that should be asked when we look at the association between fatigue and injury. And there is a claim that fatigue is being associated with a higher injury risk, but actually we don't know if this holds true. We don't have hard evidence on that. So what we did in this study, again, let me remind you that we had the RPE recorded in every training session, and we had also the fatigue status as monitored. And what is interesting was that despite the change in RPE, fatigue state reported was constant throughout the season in these football players, which might indicate that either the players of this level, high-level players, regulate their pace, or the tools we use are not sensitive enough to detect fatigue. Something is happening there. In terms of the pacing of the players, I bring into your attention this nice graph by Tucker, published in British Journal of Sports Medicine, which describes the regulation of RPE in self-paced exercise. And simply, if I try to make it simple, I would say that the highly experienced players have a preset, they have an anticipated RPE, which is actually determined by previous experience, motivation, external competition, the expected outcome of the game, or the expected plan of the games for the next 3-4 weeks when we have congested fixtures, the physiological input before exercise. So all these parameters are integrated to set the RPE before exercise. When they start playing the game, then the physiological changes through afferent feedback give information to the brain about the actual state of the body. This input is integrated and compared with the preset value of the RPE, and then the players might adjust their pace in order to keep the RPE at the level that was preset. And actually, it seems that the work rate and the RPE may be adjusted in order to match the anticipated RPE. This is still in theory. We don't have direct evidence, but I would like to bring into your attention some indirect evidence from the data from the last two World Cups. In the last World Cup, together with FIFA, we monitored the environmental conditions and also the performance, physical and technical performance parameters during the World Cup. And to make the story simple, from this analysis, total distance was not different between the different environmental conditions, from cold, relatively cold, neutral, and hot environment, whereas high intensity distance was lower in the heat and the number of sprints was lower in the heat without a change in peak speed. The number of passes was the same, was across the different environmental conditions, whereas the rate of successful passes, which might be a good indicator of technical performance and determinant and the key determinant of football performance, was improved in the heat, which might indicate that players regulate their pace in order to preserve key performance indicators, at least players of this high level. In the World Cup of 2010, the players experienced the effect of altitude on performance. And as you can see from the performance analysis data of this World Cup, the total distance covered was lower when the matches were performed in high altitude, but the top running speed was not affected, and also the goals scored per game was not different between the different altitude, the different altitude, which again might be an indication of the players regulating their pace in order to preserve the key performance indicators. Going back into the workload and injury story, this is the first study with the GPS-derived variables and injuries in soccer. This was published in the early 2017 in British Journal of Sports Medicine, and the data are from youth football players. And from this extensive analysis of the data, the authors were able to show only a relationship between the high-speed distance run, acute to chronic workload ratio, and the non-contact injuries. So only high-speed distance was associated with the non-contact injury risk. And in terms of the other factors, only the acceleration was associated. And actually, the way that the authors analyzed the data showed that those that had more than 9,000 accelerations within 3 weeks were at a higher risk of injury. And I would like to stay a little bit more into this presentation, into this study, to show you the difficulty or the challenges that the scientists might face into interpreting this data. So acceleration, which is a hot topic, is an attractive metric nowadays, is not so simple to quantify. And in a very nice study, subsequent study by a group from Australia and Aspar Academy in Qatar, they did an analysis of the acceleration efforts using different minimum effort durations and different filtering methods. And without going into more details, I would like to draw your attention into this graph, which shows that as the minimum effort duration changes in the analysis, the same holds true for the acceleration, the number of accelerations. And when the researchers used different filters, then they found different number of accelerations. The point here, to make the long story short, is that we should be more concerned about how to analyze the data and possibly give more time and build more understanding about the new metrics that appear in the literature. The story becomes more complicated. It's not only acceleration and other factors, it's the fact that the teams, even at the high level, they used so many different metrics to quantify the training load or the match load, which makes the story very complicated. And actually, this might be a factor that, despite the huge increase in the number of studies in football science, and despite the efforts and the dedication of the sports science and sports medicine staff in the clubs, the number of injuries, and especially the hamstring injuries, has not changed over the period of 10 to 12 years. Okay, so what can we do from here? What's next? This is, I had the opportunity to contribute with other excellent colleagues into this athlete monitoring cycle practical guideline, which was published a couple of weeks ago in British Journal of Sports Medicine, where we tried to put together all the different pieces in the puzzle. And we had reality, we quantified the external load, the internal load, the perception of well-being, and the readiness for the players. And we could use a pathway like this in order to interpret the data. To give you an example, if, let's say, for a player, the external workload is high and the internal workload is low, it seems that there is no big concern. This is an indication of adaptation, and we should keep monitoring the player, but he's able to accomplish the training. In another case, when the workload is high, but the perception of well-being is poor, then we possibly need to consider to reduce the workload. When the perception of well-being is good, but the readiness and the resilience is good, then this is a very good sign, and the player seems to be able to return to train and return to play. And I would like to stay more on the readiness, because I think this is a new area that we can invest more time and help the coaches, fitness coaches and technical coaches to describe better training programs by showing you some examples of how to use very simple, easy to use tests to quantify potential risk for injury in football players. In this study, we had players, youth players. They played an international friendly match, and we had we did very simple tests for hip strength and hip flexibility before and after the match. And this is the relationship we found. As the player load increased, the change in hip flexibility also increased, which might be an indication of higher risk of injury. By looking at this graph, we can also observe that this relationship does not hold true for all players. And as you can see, there are players that do not follow this pattern, where other players for the same workload present a very big change in the parameter that we measured, which actually indicates that we should look very much into the individual. And we should, I think that's the future of sports science in football, individualized training and individualized approach in the injury prevention. Again, let me remind you that despite this effort, it seems that possibly we are not making as much impact as we expect in the field. And this is not only my perception, is also what the information we collect from the practitioners, which actually stated in this study that the actual perceived effectiveness of their approach in injury prevention and performance enhancement with their methods was lower compared to the expected one, which might mean that we need to change something. And from what I've learned in the literature, it seems that in order to reduce injuries and hence achieve top performance, we must improve coaches or managers, players and decision makers' perception and trust on applied science as a tool to solve practical problems. So I believe we should invest more time into building this relationship and get the decision makers on board and improve their engagement with our ideas. Thank you very much for your attention.